Broadcasting live from a glass pane factory, this is Pop Culture Reference, your one-stop reference for all things pop culture. I'm one of your hosts, Garrett Strother.
And I'm your other host, Seamus Connolly. And I think we're back, Garrett. I think we're in the swing of things again. And I think it's going to be an absolute whirlwind. Just much like the movies themselves, it's going to be a whirlwind to talk about all three John Wick movies today.
I like that you say all three, like we're not specifically covering these because Chapter 4 just came out. I mean,
all
theaters.
Three current, past, initial John Wick movies. I mean, I've never been more excited for Chapter 4, if I'm being honest, even though these movies are not as good as I thought they might have been. But
yeah, I think that is true.
You know, I think I'm ready for Chapter 4 and maybe 5. I mean, there's for whatever reason no end in sight, it feels like, for this kind of storyline, so we'll see what happens.
People say 4 is the best one, is actually what I'm hearing.
Oh,
so
wow, okay. I mean, I will get into it in the main segment, but, you know, 1 is still pretty solid, so I'd be pretty happy if 4 comes through.
They all have things that they do well, that if 4 can combine all of those things and take away some of the bad things, very interested.
I cannot wait to see what happens with that, but why don't we get into a little bit of news before we get too far into the Assassin-verse?
Seamus, we talk so frequently about bad news of the way that, you know, corporate greed is ripping away the content, the art, the cinema that we hold dear, but today I'm here to say that we have a piece of Netflix niceness.
I was about to react like it was a fire again, like I usually do, but it's gotta be, I'm just like humbly accepting the scraps that we are being offered today. I've got my prayer hands a la Michael Bluth in Arrested Development right now.
Perfect, because Arrested Development, after a new licensing deal with Disney, is staying on Netflix. So this actually gives us a little bit more insight as to why Arrested Development was going to leave in the first place, because 20th Century Television owns the rights to Arrested Development, because that was initially a Fox television show before it moved to Netflix. They've worked out a licensing deal between Disney and Netflix to allow it to stay on, and it's also going to be on Hulu. So you've got the best of both worlds right there.
Very, very good. We were talking initially about this Netflix nuisance when it was first announced, that it was like maybe just another good excuse to ditch Netflix, but I mean now also on Hulu, there's like you said, best of both worlds. I don't want to see it restricted from anyone's access. It is still some of the most incredible comedy television of all time. So it's honestly kind of a bonus that it's spreading out a little bit here.
I was just walking around my apartment, I think literally yesterday, going, beads.
Beads?
Beads?
Oh, that is some of the best. That's season 4, right? That's,
I think so, yeah.
That's some of the best of season 4 in that one line. I love it.
Oh, it's just that both of them are so good. And then Michael says something at the end like, I don't think Joe's buying it or something like that. And he's so deadpan. But let's go ahead and move on to our main segment, which I hope will not be, you know, as supersized as last week was. We don't have any Pedro going on here.
Very true.
But let's talk John Wick.
For today's main segment, we are talking about the first three John Wick films. John Wick, John Wick Chapter 2, and John Wick Chapter 3 Parabellum, the one with the subtitle.
I don't think John Wick Chapter 4 has a subtitle.
It's just 4. They bailed on that so quick, I don't know. But I thought this was a very fun, interesting, despite my opinions on how good these movies actually are as their own movies, this was a very fun couple of days watching these. I'd only ever seen the original John Wick. I've played the John Wick drinking game far more times than I possibly could remember with how insane those rules are in that game. I've always loved it as the weird, bizarre, tropey mess that it is, but these sequels were just a new, interesting, bizarre treat for me. But what do you think about these ones?
Well, I had only seen 1 and 2 once each, around the time they initially came to home video. I liked one. I didn't so much care for two, but I just never got around to three. And then, obviously, I watched it for the show. And, you know, I think better than two,
oh,
somehow.
Absolutely. Like, somehow. I'll tell you how in the main segment, but I mean...
It's such a... And I don't think this is spoilers to say that it's a very direct sequel to two.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
And it is still so much better than two.
I watched them pretty much back-to-back. Or at least I finished it back to back. I thought it was such a pleasant upgrade, considering that it really is, like, slapped up right against it. I'm not always there for it when movie franchises do that. I can appreciate it when it happens and they do it well, but for whatever reason, specifically with these three movies, having them be so close in proximity together, I think it's kind of awesome. I kind of think it's rad, and it adds to this weird saga that has been unfolding since I was in high school, and I thought it was going to be as complicated as a gold coin, but oh boy, is it way more complicated than a gold coin.
I think that unlike something like Quantum of Solace and Casino Royale, where... just the premise of that is awesome enough that it works and you feel the kinetics of going into Quantum. And we talked about that on our episode where we talked about Casino Royale and Quantum of Solace. That is a huge part of the reason for me that I like Quantum of Solace is how connected it is to Casino Royale. I do think for the John Wick movies, though, it adds a little bit of weird dissonance because the first John Wick is so scrappy. And so, like, John Wick feels so isolated despite the fact that he has things like the Continental. And then in 2 and 3, they're like, hey, we gotta build out this crazy lore for the John Wick universe. And it's like, but where was this lore 24 hours ago?
Yeah, less than a week ago, I think is what they say.
That also means that John Wick kills, like, 300 people over the course...
in, like, a week.
Of, like, a week, yeah. These movies are hard because... as fun and cool as the action is, it never really gets out of, like, John Wick is a really bad man who is a mass shooter. He is, like...
Yeah, you're not wrong. That's, like, his occupation. That's his everyday life.
You can make the argument that, especially when you get to 2 and 3, most of the people that he's killing are in this weird assassin guild, and they know what's going on. But there are people that he kills in the first couple that are just guys that have a job.
I mean, their job is... okay, all right. I can't really get into what their job is involving one Theon Greyjoy, but, you know, that's for later in the main segment. You know,
I like that you keep saying the main segment, like we're not in the main segment.
Or
right
the
now.
Spoilers, I'm sorry. It happened so suddenly. We only had a Netflix niceness, Garrett. You can't rush me. The ballooning of the lore itself through the sequels and the almost bottle, he literally globetrots at one point. I don't know if that's spoilery to say, but it feels like this weird bottle story because of the timeline and what he has to do involving certain hotels in certain cities. The inflation of the lore, the insane rate that it spikes in the sequels, I think it works enough for me because it's so silly that I don't have to take it as seriously as maybe they are trying to make it. Are they trying to make it super serious, or are they trying to let me be like, this is absolutely ridiculous and I'm having fun here? What do you think?
I think it's hard because I think it's both. I think
that's why I'm confused. I can't tell if I need to be like, I'll be seeing you. Is that important? Do I need to know what the hell that's about?
That's actually probably my favorite bit of lore in these movies, only because they don't explain it.
They do not explain it at all.
That's when this trilogy is at its best. Here's some crazy stuff. We're not going to explain it, just you're rolling with it. When they sit down with Ian McShane and he pours himself a glass of scotch and he's like, well, actually, he's always got the martini, I guess. He's
right,
got the three olive martini. But he sits down on his couch in the Continental and he goes, Jonathan, you know that you can't do this because of guild rules. And there are consequences when you break those rules.
Because there are two rules in the movie where then by the end of the next movie, there's like 100,000 rules
there's
that they
so,
have to know.
There's so
there's
many
way more
rules.
Than two. There was a simplicity at a time that I definitely appreciated. But now I'm like, give me the Continental Guild graphic novel series where I'm just gonna, it's just turning into Assassin's Creed lore where everything is so connected.
I think there's an HBO Max show, maybe? There's a Continental show,
right,
that is in development.
I did remember that was in development at one point. I didn't know if that was still happening.
We have the technology, Thomas. Continental TV show. It's going to be 3 90-minute episodes. Mel Gibson, no!
Oh, what? Wait, starring or, like, producing? What is he? What?
He's in it!
What just happened, Garrett?
There's nobody in this movie that I know.
Because, like,
oh, it's set in the past. There's a guy playing young Winston and young Charlie. Oh,
what? Because
that's
kind of
cool. Oh, yeah, there's young Lance Reddick.
Oh, man. Oh, that is weird.
I'm kind of into this, except for the Mel Gibson part.
Mel Gibson part? Yeah, that's the part where I'm having problems myself, Garrett. I don't know if you heard my reaction before. I mean, I say this having my Get the Gringo Blu-ray not 10 feet behind me on my Blu-ray shelf, but...
Yeah, but I don't know. Now Mel Gibson, I just feel like... I mean, not that he wasn't already bad when Get the Gringo came out.
Get the Gringo was like 10 years ago, dog. I don't know if that was that long. You have like Mad Max. That was fine, I think, maybe back then.
Oh, yeah, because it's 1979 or whatever.
Yeah. When this first was announced, I was hoping that it was going to be basically like Lance Reddick's concierge character, the show. Because that's another thing I didn't remember. He is such a larger... Or I guess this is something I didn't know about the sequels. He's a much larger part of the overall goings-on of John Wick's adventure that I'm very happy to see that he was so highlighted.
Yeah, and I'm excited to see, not without getting any spoilers, I'm excited to see where that character goes.
Yes,
in
yes,
four.
Of course.
I enjoyed 3 enough that I'm glad I watched 2, but I cannot in good conscience really recommend people watch 2, even though if you're gonna watch 3, you should watch 2.
That's where I'm at right now. I think if you're going to watch them, you watch them all and you watch them in either one sitting or in like 2 days. I don't think I could have even gotten through the second one as much as I did, with as much attention as I paid to it, if I didn't bump it right up with the ending of 1 and the beginning of 3. I think I would have just gotten lost in the sauce more than I did and just almost ignored all of it. I found myself getting so bored with that second one, even though... It's John Wick. It should be all excitement, basically. But even the action was getting me yawning.
There are some highlights, I think, in 2 that we'll get into in spoilers. But it's a mistake, and I know this is funny for somebody who just said that the Continental show sounds interesting. Their big mistake in 2 is that they think we care about the lore, which we don't. We don't care about the lore.
Well, I mean, there's
we don't
so
care
much
about the lore.
Stupid.
The way it's
okay,
presented
sure.
in 2.
Yeah, okay, yes, yes.
It
the
goes
way
back
they
to what
develop
I was...
it further in 3, that's when it comes around.
It goes back to what I was saying before, I think, about in 1, almost none of the lore is explained. And so it's just this weird assassin society that exists in New York City and you don't really understand what's going on and what's the deal with the coins and why, you know. And then you get to 2 and they're like, well, here's the reason for everything. And I just don't want that. When I want the world expanded, I want it to be cool. I don't want it to be a rule book.
That's another bit of a problem that I have as these movies are going forward. And when do we call spoilers? We're pretty much just, we're laying it out there.
Yeah,
point,
okay,
but...
let's go ahead and call spoilers. I apologize that we're calling it mid-thought. We like 1. We'd like 3, not as much as 1, but more than 2, because 2's not good.
2 has to be there for dumb building blocks that come back, but yes, I agree. But they are trying to have their cake and eat it too, with like the logistics of the Continental and the High Table, and having it be like, oh, the High Table is still this super mysterious thing. The Elder is this person who's obviously somehow younger than John Wick, who's in charge of things right now, and... That's not going to get explained, but then they want us to adhere to the strictness of these rules that they're keeping half mysterious, half explained. It gets a little muddy in that, right? And that's when it's like the rules of the weird switchboard room that has vaguely misogynistic overtones that is like the
that
core of the assassin
thing.
World. It's all women and the guy who plays the Penguin in Gotham.
I thought that was the Penguin.
I had to pause it because I did think it was like another badass, tatted up woman who's like on a typewriter and like in big winged glasses like it's the 50s.
Well, it's interesting because that aesthetic, it's a very hipster aesthetic, right? It's like the 50s fashion and accessorizing with the dark beard, sleeves of tattoos thing that was really popular in, like, way before these movies were coming out. It was, like, a really big thing in, like, 2011.
Yeah. Because they don't really introduce that switchboard until, like, towards the end of the second one,
of the second one. The thing I really like about the second one that I wish they had executed better, but I think this idea is great, is using the Continental as an actual plot device.
Mm.
Obviously, you have the action sequence in the first one with Adrian Palicki, who is great. My big takeaway from the first one is that, man, I wish they hadn't killed all these people that I would like to see in more John Wick movies.
Dude, Willem, how could they do that in the first movie?
Willem Dafoe, gone. Adrian Palicki, gone. Dennis Duffy, Dean Winters.
Oh, dude.
Gone. He goes out so hard, too.
In he that gets slammed by the side of a drifting car and shot dead from the driver's seat window. It's so brutal.
And so I wish that, you know, more of these characters would come back. But yeah, you've got that cool Adrian Palicki scene, and it's like, obviously she gets got for that. In the second one, the idea of the fight stops now, and we have a scene where our two adversaries talk. I think that's a really cool idea. Mm-hmm. And trying to put Wick in a believable situation where he would be willing to break the only rule that we have really established in this whole universe, except for the stupid marker thing, which I don't actually hate. I don't think they push him hard enough into to make me buy that he would kill this guy.
Yeah, I agree with you. I think they were going for like a shock kill thing where it's like, oh, you don't think he's going to do it, and he does it. But I was shocked in the way that I'm like, oh, this is, why would they have him do it that way? Why, like, this is a dumb, like, sure, it subverted my expectation that he wasn't going to blow this dude away in the middle of the dining room or whatever, but, like, in a way that I thought that it was not done well, so it kind of backfired.
Two is rough. I will say, I don't know if you caught this, Seamus, this is just as good a place to bring it up as any. Two UWM alumni in the John Wick universe here.
We got Willem. And who's the other one?
Chuck Awuji is in Two. He's one of the guys in Two.
What, is that true? Did I just completely miss, not notice that, I guess?
It would have been, like, really early in his career, because, like, the first thing I even really knew him in was Peacemaker, which didn't come out that long ago. Mm. So it makes sense that he would just kind of fly under the radar. He's just one of the guys that the Italian siblings are meeting with in the
club. Oh, man, I was so pumped about the, like, Italy angle, but they barely do anything in Italy, right? He, like, goes to assassinate the sister, and then she does his job for him in a really weirdly graphic kind of suicide.
It's rough. It's too much watching it.
Yeah.
That scene is well written. Like, I like the interplay between those two characters, but I think that it's too brutal. I think that this movie sometimes gets in its own way, especially too, by having the violence be too much and it overshadows everything else in the movie.
Mm. John Wick is nothing if not a highlight of excellent violence in every way, but you're not wrong. Two kind of toes the line a little more muddy than I would like.
I remember my mom and I watched John Wick Chapter 2, and I remember when we got to the pencil scene, and my mom just kept going, "This is ridiculous. This is ridiculous."
Had she never seen The Dark Knight before? That's a thing.
I think there's a difference between The Dark Knight, where it's bang, zoom, there's no one blood, and there's no
pencil,
just,
is gone.
It's just shocking. And the fact that your brain has to take a second to, like, process what happened, I think actually makes it more effective, as opposed to just, like, okay, he's gonna push it into this guy's brain through his ear, and you're gonna see all the blood, and then you're gonna see it go into a guy's eye, and then the back of his neck, and then...
Oh, God. He does the John Wick classic, where he, like, he puts the pencil in his ear, and then he pushes his head onto the pencil, where he's, like, hitting it harder so that his defense breaks. It's just, like, unbearable to watch. That is so gross.
It's too much. And I think that 1 and 3 have a really good balance of violence and comedy. Humor comes from the pacing of the violence a lot of the time. You get highlights of it in 2, especially everything with Common, who I think is great
into. Oh, hell yeah, dude. I agree.
Because they have the little moment where they're shooting each other, trying to be sly about shooting each other from across the room.
In a hallway full of people on two different levels, they're just subtly hitting each other with the silenced pistols.
Then they're at Lincoln Center and the fountain drops and they see each other across the fountain. I think that's not really funny, that's just cool.
That was just a kind of a cool sequence in that.
But then the same thing where they're like, they fall down the stairs, and then they get to the landing. The shot is at the bottom of two flights of stairs, and so you know the fact that there are more stairs at the bottom is like a promise of, like, don't worry, they're gonna fall down the stairs
some more. Oh, yeah. In three, also, there's a lot of good moments in the act, like, built up in the action with the glass factory. I mentioned before we started the knife fight, where they're just in a room of throwing knives, just nonstop throwing knives at each other.
And that's so brutal, and I think that's kind of the Chapter 3 version of the pencil scene, where you're just shocked by how visceral the violence is, but it just works so much better in 3. One, because it doesn't feel like John Wick is just destroying these guys, it feels like an actual fight, which I think is part of the reason that the brutality of 2 falls so flat sometimes, is that I'm like, John Wick could just kill anyone, no problem. It's just gonna happen. It's an inevitability that John Wick is going to kill these guys. And not that I'm ever actually afraid for John Wick in Chapter 3, but that there is a little bit more tension to it. I think also a highlight of 3 for me is during the scene in Casablanca where he and Halle Berry and her cool dogs with bulletproof vests are all in that big fight. There's the bit where Wick and the guy run out at the same time.
Actually Wick and two other guys out of bullets at the same time.
And they kind of do like a bit. They do like a Mission Impossible bit where they're like,
yeah,
oh,
dude.
And then obviously Wick gets his reload and kills them. But I'm kind of listing all of these examples in a big pot to tie it up, and I think you know where I'm going to take this, because the first shot of 2 and 3, not the first shot of 3, but very early in 3, they have Buster Keaton.
I noticed that too, and I thought I was like, I thought I didn't see it right, because it's in like a big, bright New York Times Square.
Mm-hmm. In the third one, it's in Times Square. In the second one, they're just projecting it on the side of a building.
Yeah, dude. Yes, I thought that was so interesting.
And it's clear that Chad Stahelski
could be
the director of these films, who is really good, I think, at directing, even though I don't like to. He is also Keanu's stuntman on the Matrix movies and stuff, and I think you can tell that this movie is made by stunt people.
Oh, yeah.
It's clear that he views Wick, and specifically Keanu, as a contemporary Buster Keaton, not only in the type of action comedy that he's doing, but also Keanu has this very stoic, kind of stone-faced, like, yeah, I'm just here doing my thing.
yeah.
That he does have a Keaton-esque quality, and I think it's an interesting way to kind of frame John Wick as a modern-day silent film star.
That's why I like to not take it so seriously. Like, he's lumbering through all these set pieces, decimating every single body that comes in his way, but is, you know, he's getting thrown through stuff. He's got the straight face. He's barely, like, reacting to being shot, stabbed, beaten unconscious with a pipe, got his fingers cut off. He's doing all this crazy stuff in, like, the span of a week.
What do you think of the finger? Talk to me about the finger, Seamus.
The finger? I was like, they're really pulling, because that's straight Assassin's Creed. It's the straight up the ring finger on your left hand gets chopped off in those games for dumb assassin lore reasons. So I thought it was a little weird that they strictly went that route when there's no way that they weren't aware of the other big assassin franchise has been going on at the exact same time. I got a chuckle when I did notice it in a fight, and I was like, oh yeah, he's only got 9 fingers now. Like, that's so strange. I thought it was weirder that he gave his wedding ring up, considering that was, like, the only thing that he's really been driven by for the past week of carnage. He's just like, my weird family from Belarus that I am revealing that I have now, take my thing.
I don't like that part of that's probably my least favorite part of 3, because it feels like, oh, more stupid lore. Great. I love stupid
John Wick
lore.
Is Black Widow with all the ballerina stuff and the weird, like, old woman in charge.
Okay, you put some respect on Angelica Houston's name, Seamus. I will thank you very much.
I'm sorry. Apologies. I meant more of like, these movies get progressively longer with each one, and there was some stuff that
the new one is 3 hours, I hear, so...
Are you kidding me?
No.
Dude, John Wick, don't do it to me, buddy. Come on. Have mercy on me like Francis from the first movie.
That's the other thing about 3. 3's too long. Every action sequence in 3 is like a couple minutes longer than it needs to be. I think we could probably skip. I know he needs to get out of New York, and we need to figure out a way to get him out of New York. I don't care about John Wick's weird origin story. I love it when the cool katana guys walk through the dancers stage
and
the lights are...
That was fire. They could have cut down on a whole 10 minutes of those ninja guys cutting people up if they just made it like Lawrence Fishburne is the guy that helps him get out of New York or something, and then they just double up scenes.
Exactly, and then they
could
still cut up Lawrence Fishburne when they do the Blade Runner scene on the roof where he's holding the dove, and then it goes and flies away.
Is that Adjudicator lady? Is that the lady from Mean Girls? Am I crazy?
No, it is not. It's an Adjudicator person, first of all, Seamus.
Pardon me.
They're a person.
Excuse me. Adjudicator person. Who was that? They were great.
They're like in nothing.
It must have been the voice that reminded me so much of whoever that other actor is, but they were great and like a weird Terminator going around with a neck tattoo.
It's interesting that the Adjudicator is above violence. Like, the Adjudicator does not do violence. They have other people do violence.
They hired the sushi guy to stab.
They
hire
the guy
hands.
From Iron Chef America.
Is that who that is?
Like, you know the guy at the beginning of Iron Chef who's like, in the words of my uncle, a la cuisine.
Are you messing with me? Is that really that guy?
Yeah, that's that guy.
That guy was so good in this movie. He was amazing. He was like a really funny bit when he's first introduced where he like thinks the Adjudicator is just a random person and then he drops his accent that he had laid on super thick. I thought that was very funny.
I love his weird John Wick fanboy. He's like Belloc, but if Belloc were like Indiana Jones' number one fan.
Yeah, dude, he is the Syndrome from The Incredibles. What is he before he's Syndrome?
Buddy.
Yeah, he's like that. He even has a cat instead of a dog, which I thought was a lovely little detail.
I thought that was cute, too. I'm more of a cat guy myself. I love when they get to the Continental and he gets to... Because every assassin in this is so stoic and dry, and he's just like, yeah, man, I really love killing people with my sword.
I admire you so much, bro. It made me so legitimately sad when he dies, and then he's like, I'll catch up with you, John. Don't worry about me. I'll be fine. And he's like impaled and his arm isn't working anymore and he slumps over. Oh, it made me so sad.
But I do love that the guys from the raid are his backup boys.
From the raid?
The raid? You never seen the raid?
No, I never saw the raid.
If people are not familiar, great Indonesian action films, and the guys from the raid are in a lot of American movies in kind of similar roles to this where they pop up. You're like, hey, it's
like,
the guys from the raid.
It's the guys
like,
from the raid. Hell yeah, that's dope.
They're like always together. It's always like the guys from the raid.
They're a squad. It's like dancers have troops. It's these like stunt stage fight actors have a troop.
They were Kanja Club in Force Awakens who need their money from Han Solo.
Oh, no way. That is very fine. I would not have known that.
They're also chatty. They have a really good bit at the end in the giant glass fight.
Oh, yeah,
where they're like, John, man, it's an honor to be fighting with you, just so you know. They, like, help him back up. Take a minute. You take a minute. Like, Princess Bride or something.
That's exactly what I was thinking. It was the Princess Bride. Yeah, those guys are a lot of fun. A lot more fun than some of the other enemies that go down. John Wick's superpower is blowing the brains out of every person that comes his way. And then we get, like, invincible bulletproof helmet enemy guys that come in with the Lance Reddick fight, which, granted, love watching Lance Reddick get out on the action. I thought that was great. He gets like kind of sweaty still, but he's still like, right this way, sir. Like, here are the new shotguns that will be armor piercing bullets
that will
that we can get
blow
out of
these guys' heads open like watermelons.
Dude, they go so hard with those shotguns. I thought it was interesting that they take away the one thing that John Wick does with the pistol headshots and they make him like kind of work for it. But once they get to the insane powerful shotguns, I loved it.
Well, that's the thing. It's hard because I think that fight scene, I don't like it because the movie's too long.
Mm.
It's not because I don't like the fight scene, if that makes sense. Because the idea of I have to find like chinks in these guys' armors to kill them through
Mm-hmm.
And then compound that with, we're in a swimming pool and our bullets don't go very far, so I have to get, like, right up next to your neck to shoot you.
I think bullets go a little farther than that underwater, right? Am I crazy?
I thought it was fun. I don't really care.
Such a weird, limp little bullet.
I way prefer the katana glass slicing, throwing John Wick through IKEA bookcases up in the big room than I do to the rest of that continental fight, because that continental fight, again, is just too long, much like every other action sequence. I know that we're really just talking about John Wick 3, which I think is interesting.
It's the one that we were both so unfamiliar with. It's surprisingly good. It makes sense.
It's basically the Warriors, right? It's just, I gotta fight my way through New York City, and there's all of these fun little gangs that have their own thing. I think probably my favorite action sequence in the entire series is the motorcycle chase toward the third act.
Where he's got his own katana on the motorcycle.
On the motorcycles, and he's just sending motorcycles into each other. Guys are hopping from motorcycle to motorcycle.
Smashing visors with the flat of his katana before he, like, sticks it in the tire and, like, explodes their motorcycle.
I like it when the guy's hand gets caught in the spokes of his own bike,
That sucks so bad. I loved it.
That's the perfect balance of brutal violence, funny comic timing of the violence, and also just being cool. I think that's the perfect equilibrium. We also got to talk about the horse.
The horse who he's just using as an absolute weapon to kill men in ways that are too brutal for me to think about.
When that guy gets kicked in the face
twice, he makes sure he does it like twice fast, like to be a real jerk. Like, I would rather get stabbed or shot in the head instantly by John Wick any day rather than, oh no, John Wick's here and he has a horse, he's gonna kill us all. Oh god.
No, I agree. Same thing with the first kill in the movie with the book. I just like, yeah, just shoot him in the head, man. That's rough.
Please. He's so good at doing all this. I look back on, like, the... Have you ever seen his training videos at, like, the gun range?
I have.
He's training in between John Wick movies. That it makes me... It feels great that he really does do, like, 90 to 95% of everything that John Wick does on screen. It makes it feel, if not a little weird, because we have talked about some of his more lumbering, wide movements that he does when he's doing the physical hand-to-hand stuff.
But I think that's character, you know? I don't mind
exactly. It's this tired old... He was retired, damn it. He was out of the game, and he got dragged back in. It works. It works really well. It's great when I can see Keanu's face, like, gritting his teeth when he's doing, like, real action stuff.
I've just got so much stuff to say about 3. I'm feeling bad because I feel like we're neglecting 1. There's so many other really cool things in 3 that I like him doing the good, the bad, and the ugly jerry-rigging the revolvers together. Yeah.
That made me laugh big time, because at first I was like, okay, he's doing a John Wick thing, until he put it up to his ear to listen, and then I was just like, this is the absolute best. I'm big time on this right here.
I think the best part of these movies is the concierge and John Wick's dog. They are best friends.
They have such a relationship. I love it. And we still don't know the name of that dog, but I want it to be in conjunction with the concierge. Do we know, did Lance Reddick film for John Wick 4?
He just died, so I'm assuming he's in it. I haven't seen...
I guess I was more asking, like, do we know if that character is sticking around? They're so connected. I mean, if we haven't said already, they end 3 like they end 2, just like leading right into what's happening in the next scene pretty much. So
yeah, I hate that. That's the one part. Something like Casino Royale, where that's the end of his arc, is the fact that, like, we're back in the action.
Mm-hmm.
That is a character moment. One, it makes you hyped because, yeah, like, the next thing is coming. But it also has the satisfaction of, oh, Bond has been on this journey that has led him to this exact moment. And that's telling us something about the character.
Mm-hmm.
As opposed to in John Wick 2, it's just like, well, John, there's about to be a bunch more guys coming after you.
You got 1 hour, John.
How do you feel about the twist at the end of 3 where Ian McShane shoots him?
I mean... I think it's kind of lame, if I'm being honest.
Me too.
I like that character a lot. I think the relationship that they had seemed like, with a lot of other of the, like, leaders of the different factions under the table, they were about to mutiny a little bit against the table to be like, well, John Wick here is showing us that there are a lot of holes to be poked in the structure of what we have going on here, and maybe the table isn't all as all-knowing as we are giving them credit for. And then he's just like, oh, I get to keep my hotel instead of finding an interesting way to keep it or some way to, like, be a part of this society. I'll shoot John Wick in the bulletproof Italian suit, throw him off the roof.
I thought they were gonna do, like, John Wick died in that refinery explosion, didn't you see? Like, I thought they were doing
oh, like he was
a calling
con. I kind of thought that, too, at first, until it was just straight up not that.
That would have been way more satisfying, even though I do like the idea of John Wick and Lance Reddick having to not be buddies, as much as it pains me to say it. I'm interested in that. I think that goes back to, don't make me do more lore.
If anything, I think this is a fun backdoor to Ian McShane getting his head blowed off by a John Wick bullet and then Lance Reddick becoming the new manager of the Continental instead of the concierge.
Oh, that'd be cool. But he's so good at being the concierge, though.
I know,
like,
but
when he was born,
has he not earned his place above that? He's defended the Continental with shotguns and stuff, man.
I know John Wick goes through a lot, and I like the continuity of 3, of that the bullet wound from 2 is still bleeding in 3.
Yeah, I like that too.
I'm sorry, there is literally no way he survives that fall.
Oh, off of the, you mean when he gets shot at?
It's so gnarly.
It's on the roof where Jack Donaghy and Avery Jessup get divorced / married, I think.
I always think of that as the rooftop from Spider-Man. Like that.
Yeah,
me
too,
yeah.
Yes, yeah.
That has a name that I can't remember right now, that garden. But also, I don't know about the implication that, like, that is on the Flatiron building.
Yeah, like, right?
Like, how does
it's
that
not even
make
the
sense?
Right shape, I don't think, to be on the roof of that building.
Because, like, those are two iconic New York City landmarks that I think it's already asking
insane
us
that it's the Continental.
Yeah, it's already asking us to suspend our disbelief that the Continental is in the Flatiron.
It's a lot. Considering that the front of that hotel looks like it's got a big C. It's not even like a secret hotel. It's an out loud hotel for secret guests.
What happens if you're just a normal guy that walks into
the Continental? Like, damn it, my layover, like my flight got canceled, I have to spend one more night. I'll just grab this hotel on the corner, and you walk in and Lance Reddick is like asking for a gold doubloon to stay there. Like, what the hell?
I know I just said I don't like it when they explain lore, but I do think it's cool in 3 they reframe the coins as, like, a social currency. Part of the weird thing about the John Wick franchise is, like, how much are these coins worth? Because
right?
Sometimes you pay for a drink with one. Sometimes you pay for a hotel with one. Sometimes you pay for a suit or a gun with one. When the guy from the Warriors,
yeah,
the cleanup
guy, the cleaner guy, the first one,
when he comes, John gives him a coin for each guy, and I'm just like, that's so much money compared to what we've seen these coins buy.
In the second movie, Ian McShane is like minting them, but then in the third movie we see like the forge, so it's like kind of all over the map here.
They kind of simplify it by just saying, like, it's more of a social thing. It's a gesture of trust, even though it is currency technically. It's more of a, like, when that guy from The Wire that he asks to watch Adrian Leakey that gets his head blown in.
Henry or whatever his name is. That makes me so sad to this day that he gets, like, nothing to do.
And he's like, yeah, here, you want to earn a coin? Would you do me a favor, basically?
Yeah, I do like that it is kind of just boiled down to that a little more. It's just, it's an explanation that asks you to not think about it as hard, and I can kind of accept it.
Yeah.
Like that. Kind of the same way I can kind of accept the marker thing, which you saying you didn't dislike that. I didn't really dislike that either. I just think it's a little funny where it's like, here's all these hard, fast rules that bind every assassin worldwide to a set of, you know, strict things that they can and can't do. But then you can also kind of just convince somebody, if you have their marker, to do a thing for you.
Uh-huh.
And it's like weird medieval pirate
because
assassin social. That makes no sense.
They're so mad at John Wick for killing the guy who had a seat at the high table, but they're not going to be mad at that guy for gunning for his sister's seat at the high table? In that,
yeah,
like, the marker?
Exactly.
Because the marker, even though apparently nothing supersedes the high table except the marker supersedes, like, it's okay for him to ask John Wick to kill somebody from the high table.
I also imagine that when it becomes public, it was like, he was gunning for his sister's seat, so he hired somebody to assassinate her, and then double-crossed him in a way that exploits the system of the High Table. Like, how does that not get him in trouble? Like, why does he get a pass until he gets, you know, I guess, murdered? But
and I think even though there are higher highs in 3, I think that's why 1 really is the best one for me. Because it has such an emotional simplicity. It doesn't have, like, the best action or anything. It just has a really solid story that I understand the trajectory of, and it has a nice balance of the Continental is cool, but John Wick still has to be really scrappy. Like, he has to go to the vet and staple up his own stab wound.
Jesus.
As opposed to in 3, you see him go to the doctor, and it's like, why didn't you go to the doctor a week ago, John? What's going on with the weird inconsistency in the world here? And here's my big takeaway is 2 and 3 look incredible. They are some of the best action blockbusters, American action blockbusters, I should say, the last 20 years. 1 doesn't look that good, and I wish 1 looked more like 2 and 3.
You know, I can understand. 1 is so removed for me. Like, even having seen the 2 sequels for the first time and, like, getting the whole scope of what's going on in the John Wick verse here, I feel like 1 has that kind of purity where he is specifically scrappy, and the lore of the Continental and the High Table did not yet seep into his very simple revenge quest of killing a man who killed his dog. The blues and the grays that they play with more in the first one kind of do it for me, in that it's like such a weird, gloomy, almost over-the-top, depressed dude doing all this stuff, like, for the joke of what John Wick 1 is. I do still so appreciate the neon wonderland that they go into with New York stuff and the expansive set pieces for the fights that they get into in 2 and 3. I'll always stand by that. I will also say the soundtrack for John Wick 1 is banging. Better than the other two.
Tyler Bates does the music for these with somebody else who I don't know, but Tyler Bates is the Guardians of the Galaxy guy, so he does a good job, I think.
Oh yeah, there's a good level of, like, Euro techno beats to kill slash study slash relax to that we got going on in that first one.
I love the classical music with the techno stuff under it.
Oh,
too.
Yeah, dude.
I think that's really cool.
I dig that as well. There was the introduction of, like, the sommelier and stuff in the second one. Well,
those
do
are
you
fun.
Like the bulletproof vest or the bulletproof suit? Does that take away something for you?
It makes a lot of the action sequences a lot easier to swallow, is what I'll say. That is them basically being like, okay, John Wick is a little bit of a superhero now. He can take a bullet and still be fine. Sometimes it works for me better than other times. In the tunnels under the Italian ruins that he's getting chased through, the only way he gets out of this is with that bulletproof suit. I like Peter Serafinowicz as the sommelier. I think he's having a good time.
Oh, totally. Yeah.
We've barely talked about Lawrence Fishburne. We've barely talked about Halle Berry.
Oh, yeah, she's got her own set of backstory about, like, a daughter that she can't see, and, like,
that's definitely a setup for a spinoff, right?
The
Halle
Berry
sequence.
I'm starting to get scared that they're going to start adding in, like, canine companionship into assassin lore about, like, the first assassin had a dog that shaped the relationship for all assassins and dogs.
I really don't want them to do that either, because the purity of John Wick's relationship with his dog is so important. I think the Halle Berry stuff is kind of cool. And it shows, like, a relationship between her and John. I like that she's like, he shot my dog. He's like, I get it.
Yes, exactly. Even aside from that, like, honestly, really funny joke, it's like, it shows that she has that same weird level of, like, she's disconnected. She has family that is never going to be with her again, and she has to cope through non-human companionship, because every other human that they know is, like, an assassin who would maybe kill them for enough money, even inside of the hotel that they got. It's a little crazy that I don't think we brought up John Wick the other week when we were talking about movies influenced by video games, because what is John Wick if not, you know, the most video game style, get shot 1,000 times, but have, like, 100,000 bullets in your gun that you could... It's so funny that they're like, 7 bullets, John Wick, that's all you get, and then immediately abandon that concept as if
I'm just gonna take another guy's gun, I guess. You know?
I know!
I mean, I think it's cool that it makes me think about the gun as a tool, but also it's kind of undermined by the whole fact that John Wick can make anything a weapon. But the idea that 7 bullets is all you need, if you can get these 2 guys dead and then get one of their weapons, you're home free. You're done.
He can kill anybody with anything, including his hands. But he's also, again, the thing that I am here for in the John Wick movies are swift one-shot, one-bullet headshots that just down every guy in the room, one after another. And I feel like you give John Wick a gun with seven bullets, he's just like, all right, I'll just kill seven people in a row and then get another gun. And I wanted that restriction a little more, especially because that was also, I think, the same movie where they introduced the bulletproof suit. Do you have any final wrap-up thoughts? There's weirdly so much to say about these insane movies.
I really didn't think we were going to have as much to say as we ended up saying.
I know.
Yeah.
But there's so much. I hate to say, as a trilogy, it's soon to be a quadrilogy, I think I kind of love them a lot. And it kind of makes me want to jump on that John Wick video game.
I like these movies. I don't know. I don't like them as much as you do.
I will stand by the first one forever. I will not stand by the second one probably ever unless it's in conjunction with the third one,
yeah.
Which I actually think is fairly good. I think it's a good movie.
Talking about it on the show, I like the third one more. I think. I'm like,
yeah,
man,
right?
There's a lot of cool stuff in the third one.
Because they go off the absolute walls with the lore, but it's like in stupid enough and in bulk enough of a way where we're just like, we're kind of just taking it now. We're in the John Wick verse and we don't mind as much as we did maybe early on. I'll watch that super cursed Mel Gibson show at some point when that comes out, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, I probably will too. I hate that it's Mel Gibson.
Dude,
why is it
Donnie Yen and Mel Gibson are both like creeping around the John Wick verse, like slowly canceling everything?
I feel like in the eyes of the public, Donnie Yen is still mostly fine. Like Mel Gibson, why would you cast Mel Gibson in something? But Seamus, why don't we move it on over to the pop culture reference?
Let's do it.
For today's pop culture reference, we're going to be issuing a light spoiler warning. If you have not watched Season 3, Episode 4 of The Mandalorian, you may want to skip ahead. Through our Mandalorian segment, probably, which is
yeah,
coming up right after this. But for today's pop culture reference, we're going to be talking about Ahmed Best's role in the Star Wars universe. Ahmed Best is best known for his work as the motion capture and voice artist for Jar Jar Binks in the Star Wars prequel films. Though the special effects work done on Jar Jar in The Phantom Menace was groundbreaking for its time, Best was targeted directly with violent threats, racist hate mail, and unrelenting feedback of disapproval from fans and critics worldwide.
Best was unfortunately one of the first of many leads in Star Wars that were bullied for their performances to the point of personal and life-threatening crisis, including Best's on-screen co-stars Jake Lloyd and Hayden Christensen. Best continued to reprise the role of Jar Jar throughout the prequel trilogy, the Clone Wars TV show, various video games, animated Lego specials, and even direct parody projects like Robot Chicken, despite the hate and undeserved controversy he garnered from his initial role in The Phantom Menace.
Best took up another role within the Star Wars universe in 2020 with the web-based kids' challenge game show Jedi Temple Challenge as Jedi Master Kelleran Beck. Though the web series was largely considered non-canon within the Star Wars universe, the latest episode of The Mandalorian has inserted the now-canonized Beck into the story using the loose character work from Jedi Temple Challenge as its base. In interviews, Best himself has stated that Ahmed Beck, his unmasked cameo role in Attack of the Clones, and Kelleran Beck are directly related to each other, but no official source has confirmed this canon.
I know we're, like we said up top on this, we're getting a little ahead of ourselves in Mando Bros, but like, man, what an absolute surprise that
yeah.
He's being reinserted like this. I haven't gotten a chance to see the Jedi Temple Challenge, but I've seen very small clips at this point now, and it seems like it's very goofy and a lot of fun, and there's like a weird Sith Lord character that has like the final challenge
yeah.
for the kids. But
I mean, it's Legends of the Hidden Temple, but Star Wars,
Legends of the Hidden Jedi Temple Challenge.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, I think it's a very direct reference.
Yes, yes.
I remember during the pandemic, I was like, I'll watch a couple of those, and I watched, I think, two, and I was like, this is fun, and I'm glad I'm at best is back, and this is so for kids, and I'm not watching anymore.
I mean, if they had this when I was watching, like, Fetch with Ruff Ruffman on PBS as a kid, yeah, I would be watching it every day. I would be, like,
totally
trying to get on the show. That would be my whole thing. But
7-year-old Seamus' 7-year-old Garrett, like, we're Seamus and Garrett, we're from the Chicagoland area, and we're auditioning to be on Star Wars Jedi Temple Challenge.
You know, you bet your ass I would be wearing my costume shop clip-on Jedi apprentice braid that I got from a Halloween costume in that same era. I think it's fascinating the way that they're inserting Kelleran Beck, which is, I think, maybe soon to be a lot of people's favorite Jedi. We're not really quite sure what's going to happen in the future of this character, but
yeah,
I think
we're going to have to transition to Mando Bros to keep talking about it.
I think so. All I'll say is that there is finally some stuff coming around for Ahmed Best, somebody that I personally have always admired, even as a kid, as a small baby boy watching The Phantom Menace. I never had a problem with Jar Jar Binks. I was a kid and I would talk about that movie and people would be like, "And Jar Jar, am I right?" And I would just be like, "I do not understand what you're saying. I don't know what you're talking about. He's funny. He's got a good funny voice. His design is insane. I always loved him, and I'm glad he gets to kind of have his actual face come back around here a little bit.
Now, I'm gonna disagree with you on multiple points.
I know you are. I've had this my whole life, Garrett. I've been in this fight since I was 6 years old, okay? I understand.
I'm not a Jar Jar defender, but I am obviously an Ahmed Best defender, not only because the harassment and life-ruining treatment that he experienced in the aftermath of Phantom Menace and beyond is deplorable and shouldn't happen to anyone, but I also think that Best has taken it so well in such stride and has really worked hard to not let it keep him down and to continue working, not only in acting, but in the Star Wars universe. How, imagine being willing after all of that to come back to Star Wars, you know?
I admire that so genuinely. I think to this day, this, I mentioned it before, this isn't the last person who has been relentlessly bullied worldwide for just being in Star Wars and directed to act a certain way or written to act a certain way. These actors giving the best of what they have to a role that they've been given, and they're crushed for it. But this man, he took it in stride. I think it's especially admirable that he can even do things like the robot chicken and the Lego Star Wars things, where they're gonna make jokes about, like, Jar Jar kinda sucking to the other people in the universe. But, like, I think that just shows such honest bravery to be willing to go back to the frenzy of what Star Wars fans can be. And I think he's come through tenfold with the work he's been doing. I appreciate it so much.
And I'm excited to talk more about his potential role in the universe with this relatively new character when we move on to Mando Bros.
What do you say we kick it on over?
Let's do it.
Now it's time for Mando Bros, our weekly breakdown of The Mandalorian on Disney Plus. This week we're touching on what might be the shortest episode of The Mandalorian ever put out. I guess I didn't crunch the numbers on that, but this is season 3, episode 4.
Which is definitely something. Called something.
It's definitely got a name.
It's definitely called The Foundling, is what it's definitely called.
The Foundling. This is, I mean, maybe the shortest, but maybe the most whiplash I've ever gotten from a Mandalorian episode.
I thought this was not as good as the previous few episodes. I mean, well, it was, I think it's better than the premiere. It's not nearly as good as episodes 2 and 3, but it does still have some really interesting things going on, and I feel like we have to be pretty vague about everything we're talking about until we call spoilers.
I feel like we should call spoilers. Not much, like,
I agree,
outside of the world of lore has changed in terms of, like, the Covenant. Hey, let's call spoilers real quick. And Garrett, did you know that if you use blasters on that dragon bird, it'll hurt the child? Did you know that? Did you know that if you use weapons, do you know that you need to climb the mountain and not use your blaster or else it will hurt the child?
I feel like it felt like I was in the most annoying PS2
Oh,
mission
no. Yes,
I've
dude,
ever
yes.
done. And also, okay, I think you must be right about your theory that I think I even cut out of the episode where we talked about in the season opener that you're like, maybe the Mandalorians picked this planet because it's, like, dangerous. Because there's just another evil big creature that they're just hanging out on the beach and then something's gonna come attack them. Well, and that's how this world works, I guess.
It's not even just another one. It's one that they just consistently deal with. They're like, the last time this happened, we used blasters and it alerted the thing and it killed the child. And it's like, you haven't solved this problem yet? You're just like, well, the jetpacks can't go that far, so we'll wait for it to take the next one or whatever.
This was a weird episode because I thought that plot was really dumb and I didn't care at all.
And yeah, they tried to sneak in that the kid is a Vizsla. He's the son of Jon Favreau out here.
Which, who may or may not be Jon Favreau. Now I'm listening to the voice, I'm like, is it not Jon Favreau?
It might not, because I was thinking that. I was like, well, Garrett assures me that it's Jon Favreau, and I won't check, but it doesn't really sound like
him. I wonder if he was played by Jon Favreau in season one, and then they, like, changed the actor, because I am almost positive that he was played by Jon Favreau early days,
like,
man.
I remember that being true at one point, too, but he's so prevalent now. You think Jon Favreau's getting up in that armor every day for shooting?
Well, I don't think he was ever in the suit.
Oh, like the body of him?
Yeah, I think he was just the voice. I don't know. I think it also might just be the fact that Pre Vizsla on the Clone Wars obviously is played by Jon Favreau, and this guy sounds kind of like Jon Favreau, so I just kind of assumed that Jon Favreau, who makes this show, is in that suit. It also makes it seem to me like all of the tension that I thought we were alluding to at the end of last week with maybe Paz Vizsla is going to have some problems with Bo-Katan and Mando. Seemingly no, because they just saved his child.
Like, not only that, it's like, it seems like out of nowhere, Paz Vizsla, he doesn't really care about the plan or the thing that the Mandalorians are supposed to be doing, which is like hunting in a smart way. He's just like, that's my boy in there! That's my boy! And he runs in head first like nothing matters, and then they save him, and it seems like they're buddy-buddy now, so...
It feels like an episode of The Bad Batch where they come back and they're like, yeah, we got these babies to raise. And
dude,
like,
yeah, that's what I thought too. That what are they going to do with those? Like, what is the plan? I mean, I know they're going to raise and ride them,
in the season finale, when Bo-Katan rides the Mythosaur, the other Mandos are going to ride those things.
And then they're going to be like, hey, I know a Mandalorian who runs Mos Espa who rides another giant monster. Let's call him in.
Don't.
You know it's going to happen, dude. You know it's going to happen. I can't let you think that it's not, because you're going to hurt more when it does happen.
I'm not prepared for the inevitable Boba Fett showing up on this season of The Mandalorian.
You just have to let it wash over you and trust that. Well, no, Robert Rodriguez will definitely direct that episode, too, so I can't even say that it won't happen.
No.
I'm sorry, buddy.
Robert Rodriguez, do good things again, please.
Isn't it funny how the only Robert Rodriguez things we've ever done on the show are the worst things ever? Between the Book of Boba Fett and We Could Be Heroes? Like, what are we doing? People who don't know Robert Rodriguez, besides through this show, think he's bad, and that's a disservice. Back to the important part, the important half of this episode, or I guess the important 10 minutes of this episode.
I want to save that for last, Chavis, because once we're done with this, we're not going back to the stupid Mandalorians.
We've got gaslit Bo-Katan, who's like, I swear I saw it, and they're like, I see it every day, pal, you know? Like, the armorer does not care that she straight up saw a Mythosaur. It's very goofy, but like... You know, there's some weird, she says this is the way, and she's got the signet of the Mythosaur now, and we're kind of seeping more into that, but she's gonna have to straight up bring the Mythosaur to this weird planet that they're hiding on for them to believe it.
Did you know that, your ancestors ruled the great Mythosaur?
That's my favorite impression that you do, I think. I really did think you were gonna say, did you know that, if you use your blasters, you can alert the beast and hurt the child.
That'd be pretty funny, too. I like the little Grogu sending this kid to school.
Mando school? That's pretty fun.
With the paintballs and, like, I like that Grogu He's like, I am above this. I will. Yeah, he's I holding do not back.
Little baby green boy is holding back that he could, like, John Wick snap this kid's neck if he wanted to. If he does his backflip and gets around him.
Imagine how, like, because Ahsoka would be like, yeah, boy, you show him. But I feel like Luke would be like, okay, Grogu, we know we're not supposed to do that.
Yeah, Luke Skywalker, what a wet blanket. He's not, he's trying to...
That's what I've always said about Luke Skywalker. He's a buzzkill.
I bet he trains a bunch of murderers later in his life, you know? I like that the Mando gear that they're making for him, like, the armor makes him a new pendant to, like, be, like, a weird... Like bullet a in a Bible plate. Style chest plate, which I like.
I was thinking about Good, Bad, and the, or not Good, Bad, and the Ugly. That's Fistful of Dollars.
That's Fistful of Dollars. Yeah, yeah, exactly. A lot of Mando gear seems to be usable by him, regardless of his weird species and size. So I'm excited to see him get decked out a little more.
The kid asks why he doesn't wear a helmet, and now we're certain that Grogu is going to talk in this show because he says that Grogu can't speak yet to take the creed. And they're already kind of teasing it with the joke from last week where he tries to say, this is the way.
Oh, you know he's going to say, the way this is, and get a new helmet. I mean, it's got to happen.
Yeah. That's,
do you think that's a... Does Yoda have a speech impediment, or is that just how they speak? Is that... How does
Yaddle
that work?
In the Tales of the Jedi show does not speak backwards.
You're kidding me. Yoda's just like that? That's just how he learned to speak? That's very funny.
I believe that... Frank Oz, this is definitely not canon. I remember reading a Frank Oz interview once where he was talking and he was like, well, in my thoughts, Yoda talks like that because his master spoke like that. And so it's his way of carrying on the wisdom of his master.
It could just be whoever trained him was a species that spoke trade common like that.
Like, I mean, Yoda. Like Yoda speaks. Yeah.
I guess that's... Fair. I was kind of expecting little baby Yoda speak this whole time. How insufferable might that turn into?
I don't know. Yoda never gets annoying to me, really, so...
But he's, like, cute old man. This would be, like, baby cooing gibberish nonsense also speaking in tongues kind of thing.
Yeah,
I feel like that might get a little...
Know.
That wear might wear on you.
Okay, I think now it's time, Seamus, to talk about our snipe.
Yeah! I was thinking about this, too. We called it from... 10 parsecs away, baby. We absolutely made this. We manifested this like The Secret. It's amazing.
It's really crazy that, as mentioned during our pop culture reference, Ahmed Best in a flashback to Order 66 is not only back in the Star Wars universe, but the guy who got Grogu out of the Jedi Temple.
Canonical, absolute, uber badass Kelleran Beck, double lightsaber, slaying the 501st at the Jedi Temple. I was so shocked and taken aback when that elevator opened and our boy hit him with the come with me if you want to live, Sarah Connor style.
Mm-hmm.
But man, the speeder chase through Coruscant, awesome. The lightsaber play is incredible. And
we get to see the mountain again.
Which yeah, the mountain. Cool. Dude, I noticed that too. That was two episodes in a row. I liked that in different eras of what that mountain represented.
Mm-hmm.
But am I crazy in assuming that, let's say there's a total of 3 senators from Naboo on Coruscant?
This is what we're getting to. Yeah. Okay. So let's think about this, right? We know that the Nubian starfighter that he brings Grogu to that has Naboo guards waiting with it, so it's
and
not...
And Naboo blasters with that patented sound that I mm-hmm. love oh so much.
So we know it's a Naboo ship, it's not just a Nubian starfighter that is, you know, used by somebody else. It looks just like the one that Padme uses in episodes 2 and 3, but we know it's not hers, because...
hers is very specifically on Mustafar.
Well, it's about to be on Mustafar,
right.
More accurately.
In route, too. Or I guess maybe a little later.
There's a couple of questions here, because... If it's not Padme's, and Padme, we know Padme is not involved in this little plot here, it could be that Bail Organa sent somebody, theoretically, even though he's from Alderaan.
He's from Alderaan, my friend.
But there is somebody who may be looking to repent for their actions, who may be a senator from Naboo, who may have access to a Nubian starfighter...
Misa excited, Garrett. Misa very excited is all I can say. I could not want anything more than the double redemption. One of of a character that was so wrongfully tarnished that I will stand by. Jar Jar Binks could be the savior of Grogu, the Mandalorian.
And don't even forget, what does Grogu eat all the time?
Jesus Christ, it's Jason Bourne. Oh my God, I didn't even think of that part of everything, dude. That is so incredible. Kelleran Beck, God bless him. That is the new man for sure. But could you imagine Kelleran Beck and Jar Jar Binks being close personal friends that they have like each other's communicator frequencies to get out of there? I would love that kind of interaction. It would maybe literally give Ahmed Best time on screen to like make a weird kind of peace with the character of Jar Jar Binks in a way that would like quell some rabid fans who would take any chance to dunk on Jar Jar. But I think
in the last few years, especially with the rise of like sequels are the trendy thing to hate right now, a lot of Star Wars fans are like, we never hated Jar Jar. That was toxic people. That
fake
wasn't
fans.
Us. The real fans always stood by the prequels, which is just not true.
Fully not true. I'm glad I was born at a time where I was too young to know what I was looking at on the VHS tapes of my prequel movies, but
I feel like he has to be going to the Gungans, right? Like, he has to be going to the Gungans. Like, where else is he going?
I guess it's lesser of a new character than I thought after doing our research on Kelleran Beck as a game show, intergalactic game show host on Coruscant. But I want this character to be, I want, like, a lot more of Kelleran Beck in whatever that may be, comics or a spin-off show or a whole episode where it's, like, him and Grogu trying to get to Jar Jar or the Gungans or something. I'm just really hoping he doesn't die in some way. Well, I know
it's
also
funny you say that, because I was about to say, I hope he dies soon.
No!
Not because I have any problem with Ahmed Best or Kelleran Beck, but because every time they introduce a new Jedi that survived Order 66,
I'm
like,
I know.
We need to kill this guy. And sometimes they're good at doing that. You know, and I don't know what's going to happen in Jedi Survivor, of course, that's coming up soon.
Oh my, could you imagine, dude, if Kelleran Beck in Jedi Survivor would be
that's
amazing.
Not even what I'm talking about, but okay.
That's what I'm talking about, dog.
We have so many people we want to, every week we come up with a new person we want to be in Jedi Survivor.
Kumail from Obi-Wan is
that is the one that we both want, yes.
yeah.
When we know where certain legacy characters end up. That they die in a certain way or that they have an ending that is satisfying. But some of these more open-ended characters like Cal Kestis, like Kelleran Beck, I'm like, okay, I need us to cool it a little bit on adding Jedi that survived the Purge. Also, I hate to say this, I just want to watch the show that is Grogu on the run after Order 66. We could just fully get rid of the stuff
the
that's going on in current day Mandalorian.
Honestly? Hell yeah, dude. I would be really interested to see something like that, especially with what seems like crazy liberties they're taking on, like, how the hell did Grogu do the things that he did without being found out or hurt by the time that, like, the Empire has fallen? So, I mean, there's gotta be a lot that goes down.
I think regardless, even if he's not going to the Gungans, even if we're not getting Jar Jar, I think we're going to Naboo soon, so I'm very excited about that. Again, we sniped
it. Our mutual favorite planet, maybe? One of our favorite planets?
It's certainly my favorite planet. I said that on the show a couple weeks ago, and I meant it.
Yeah, it's incredible. I love it. I want more there. We both already know some stuff that they do in like the comics and other things where they go back to Naboo with very interesting angles post Phantom Menace, post, you know, Order 66 stuff. So I'm very curious to see if it's just that, how that's gonna go.
As anticipated, I think now that we've talked about the flashback sequence, I think we're done talking about
again
Mando.
This was like 29 minutes flat. You take away, it was like 32 minutes with credits and the intro or something. It's not a lot happened, but I'm excited for next week to see more of this flashback that I assume we're getting.
It's a mixed bag, but it's keeping me engaged more than I thought it was going to. So
I think last week we both said like this episode is going to be the decider, but now it's like, you get one more week, Mandalorian, or it's your badge on my desk.
If it had just been the foundling gets taken
the dragon
by,
thing?
Then it would have been like, well, but
it was a good run. But now we're limping along just a little bit further. That I'm still pumped for Wednesday.
But let's go ahead and save the Jedi Temple. I mean, save the Rec Center.
Let's save it.
Save the Rec Center! Now it's time to save the Rec Center, where we bring you our weekly recommendations. Seamus, what do you got for us?
Well, with our main segment today, I am rec-centering an assassin-based piece of media. Until about the beginning of this week, I had never thought I would ever play an Assassin's Creed game again after Black Flag, which was a launch game for PS4, maybe the best pirate video game ever made, like, regardless of its ties with Assassin's Creed. And after that, I was just like, well, everything kind of sucks now, and they changed the controls, and the lore is just, like, absolutely all over the place. I care less and less every time I play it. But I gave Assassin's Creed Rogue Remastered a shot the other day. It is a game that I've always wanted to play, but it came out at the exact same time as Black Flag as a PS3 exclusive.
I remember that coming out, yeah.
What a jerk move to dangle an awesome concept like, you are an ex-assassin turned Templar hunting assassins. That's awesome. Why keep that exclusive to a generation that was already on its way out? But now, because of the PS Plus collection, I gave it a shot. Incredible. It's everything that I missed about Assassin's Creed. It's the classic controls. It's the classic wall climbing that doesn't make you rip your hair out. The naval combat that Black Flag perfected, and they just copy and pasted that exact same thing over to this game. Brand new maps of, like, northern Canadian wilderness territory, frontier stuff. Doesn't, you know, hit you over the head too hard with the war, the 7 years war thing that they're building up to. It's a lot of fun, dude. If you liked Black Flag in any way, if you miss when Assassin's Creed was a lot more simple and just there for the fun of it instead of how bloated they could possibly make it, it's definitely worth checking out, especially since it's been remastered only a couple years ago, and for the first time playable on not a PS3. So it's definitely a hidden gem.
I have never actually played Black Flag, so I think I've got to get to that first.
Oh, yeah, dude. Definitely do that first, and then go over to Freedom Cry, which is the slave liberation mini story, and then go over to Rogue, because that's like a little trilogy of peak of Assassin's Creed and the last time it was ever good, basically. So it's definitely worth checking out.
Well, you know, I didn't have a PS4 for a long, like, I never had a PS4, so PS5, it's on the PS Plus collection, I believe, so I should just download it and
technically,
check
I think
it out.
Every single one is on the PS Plus collection except for the original, which was never remastered in any way, so
I think they took Valhalla off now, too.
Ah, I see.
Which I actually rec-centered a few years ago on this show. I do like Valhalla, but I think, like most of those bloated modern Assassin's Creed games, it's way too long, and I'm more interested in the aesthetics of it than I am the actual story or gameplay. Especially things like Odyssey and Origins. I am way more interested in the discovery mode, the museum mode of those, where you're just learning and experiencing the world. Valhalla, I think, is a little bit better, but I've always heard great things about Black Flag. Black Flag was, even in an era where I didn't play a lot of video games, a video game I was very interested in playing.
Definitely do that, and then, you know, if you're so inclined, which you will be because Black Flag is kind of a, weird to say it, a modern masterpiece of gaming, Rogue is right around the corner for you, and it's another, like, really interesting, fun story with pretty much a copy and paste of all of the fun mechanics that they got rid of in the new stuff. But what do you have this week to save the Rec Center?
I've been going back and forth on a couple of different things. I've been watching a lot of stuff lately. Not all of it has been great, but last night I rewatched the original 1978 Superman with Christopher Reeve. And stop me if I've rec-centered this before, Seamus, because I will rescind and go back to something else.
I want to say you have. We've talked about the Christopher Reeve Superman a lot, but I'm not sure if we've done specifically a rec-center on it.
I love it so much. I think it's such a breath of fresh air in the contemporary superhero landscape where I said to our boy Fritz while we were watching it last night, I was like, his suit is so cool. And he was like, is it? And I was like, yes. It's so
just like a cloth jumpsuit, isn't it? But
it's bright and colorful and iconic. Mm. The design is fantastic. It perfectly adapts how Superman looks in the comics to live action. It doesn't have to be this weird chainmail mesh that's all dark colors and
totally.
Just let it be bright and cool and wondrous. And I think that's the thing that really stands out to me about that original Superman is, one, it really takes his time to let you get to know Clark as a guy before he ever becomes Superman. But it also revels in the wonder of, you know, you'll believe a man can fly. That's the tagline for the movie, right?
Mm.
That's something that we don't do in superhero movies anymore. I gotta say, actually, this is very decidedly not my rec center, because I don't think it's actually a good movie despite how much I enjoyed it. The new Shazam has some moments where they go back to a little bit of the classic stuff, much like the first Shazam does, where they show him saving people. They show him really enjoying flying and being a superhero in ways that most modern superhero movies don't allow you to just experience, like, wow, this is an amazing thing that's happening. I also like that the first Superman is positioned as something of an epic. There are these great widescreen sweeping shots of the Kansas plains as Clark and Ma Kent look out to the horizon and wonder what's ahead, you know?
Wow, no kidding. I actually didn't know that about this original one.
It should be what's a grounded, very simple scene, but they treat it like it's the most important thing that is happening in the universe. Obviously, it's dated. It's from the 70s. You know, some of the effects look pretty rough, and the pacing is really slow, but it all works for me. I think it's kind of the perfect summer movie of just like, man, this is a good time at the movies. And it's effects heavy, but it's character driven, and you like the characters, and it's funny and sweet and scary and stupid and campy. And we've been in something of a Superman drought, and we talked about this a little bit when we talked about Black Adam. And something a little bit, we talked a little bit about this last week during the Superman James Gunn news. People don't engage with Superman very much anymore in the way that character is traditionally portrayed. And I think that it's the best on-screen Superman there's ever been.
I talked a little bit last week when we were talking the new Superman Legacy news about how, like, my Superman is Man of Steel, and I hate that it is, but I think if I just don't overthink it, take a step back, go back to the classics like that, I think I would have an incredible time. I know you've talked up Superman many times before, but I want to do it. I want to go back, maybe get a couple people who haven't seen it ever or, like, who are less familiar with it, because I want to be in on those, like, novelties that will weirdly seem fresh to me, having, like, no idea what's coming in Superman, but, like, that epic stuff, the special effects that, I mean, whatever, it's not modern, contemporary kind of special effects, but it's gonna have that character to it that makes Superman what it is, and that's why I'm gonna heed your rec center, Garrett. I'm gonna sit down with that one. But that wraps us up for the show this week. If you want to reach the show on social media, that's at @PCR_podcast on Twitter, Instagram, and TikTok. And if you want to reach the show directly, you can email popculturereferencepod@gmail.com. Please like, subscribe, rate, review, do anything that interacts with our show on whatever platform you're listening on. Go to our YouTube page. That's one we haven't plugged in a while. All our full episodes are up on there. Lots of good stuff. Just engage with us wherever you can, and that'll help us out a lot.
Next week on the show, I'm very excited to say we're going to be covering Dungeons & Dragons, Honor Among Thieves, the new Dungeons & Dragons movie. Very curious to see how it is. The trailers look good. I like Game Night, which is the same creative team.
I'm hearing really good early reviews so far. I'm hearing a lot of fun things.
I'm still skeptical, but I'm very excited.
Me too. As two boys who have very recently actually started playing Dungeons & Dragons, it's finally a long time coming from episode one, where Dungeons & Dragons was my rec center. We're finally here.
Was that true?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure that's episode one.
Wow, that's crazy.
Like 4 years before I would ever actually roll a D20 at a table, I was like, I listened to a podcast about Dungeons & Dragons that I like, and that was how that went.
Seamus, you are a silly, goofy little boy.
I really am. I have high charisma, low intelligence, as it were.
I can't wait to see Chris Pine walking into walls next week as he fails his saving throws.
Oh, cannot wait. Adios, amigos.